What you're going to hear today is part two of a four-part series, a book that we're trying to complete. Part one is called The Divine Decalogue for Dynamic Decency, and it places the Ten Commandments in positive paraphrases so that we understand the benefits that result when we as individuals and as societies live by them. Part two is called The Biblical Basis of the Bill of Rights. I'm going to give you a little bit of an overview, a quick overview of part one today. But part two is called The Biblical Basis of the Bill of Rights, which is what we're going to examine today, which shows that the Founding Fathers' value system is actually the Ten Commandments. And they applied the Ten Commandments to civic life and government. That's why Amendment Number 1 of the U.S. Constitution begins with freedom of religion, and it conjoins all five rights. It doesn't split them into five different amendments, because religion is supposed to be the guide of all those rights. The third part, which we're not going to cover today, I'm going to actually be teaching this at Camp Constitution this summer. It's called The Politics That Pollute Paradise. And I go into a little bit of the history of the people and the personalities that Satan has worked through to deny America the opportunity to understand the value of the Ten Commandments to our civic lives. These are the people who invented the phrase separation of church and state. Well, they didn't really invent it, but they were the ones that made people believe that it is part of the fabric of our nation. That phrase neither appears in the U.S. Constitution, nor does it appear in the Bible. For if God wanted separation of church and state, he would have never drowned Pharaoh's army in the sea. God always expects the state to obey him. That's why he sent Jonah to Nineveh. The fourth part of these presentations, or the fourth part of the book, is called Prophets, Patriots, and Providence. And it's all about how God always sends his prophets to political leaders. The book of Isaiah begins with, I prophesied through the reigns of these three kings. John the Baptist, the last of the prophets, was assigned to Herod. And though John the Baptist died as a result of his confrontation with Herod, Jesus never criticized John the Baptist for trying to get the state to obey religion. Jesus said of John the Baptist, there have been none greater born than John the Baptist. So, let's launch into it today. Now, if you look at your notes, you have blank spaces. And wherever you see a blank, or you see a blue, I like to call these blue boats with the white boats with the words in them, these cells, that's the word that you fill in on your page. And the reason I do this is because I'm hoping that if you see it, I say it, and you write it, it becomes more memorable. But also, you have a takeaway. You'll have a document, a reference sheet that you can share with other people. Photocopy it, tell your neighbors about it, tell your children about it. Well, the Ten Commandments express what both divine love and divine justice requires for all human relationships. For if I love you, I'm not going to murder you or lie to you. By the same token, if I want to be just in my relationship in God's eyes with you, or my relationship with you in God's eyes, I'm not going to murder you. I'm not going to lie to you. There we go. The Ten Commandments in positive paraphrases. God is number one. Treat all people as if they are number twos. Don't you think that you're number one? And even if you know you're not a one, don't think that you're a two and I'm a three. God is number one, all people are number twos. We have a lot of trouble in the world today because a lot of people think they're number one. Commandment number two, God says make no idols. Why does he say that? It's because we imitate our idols. We reflect what we worship. We take on the characteristics and the value system of that which we worship. The world has turned sex into an idol. Much of what we see in the world is the worship of sexuality. Commandment number three, why does God say, esteem my name? He wants you to treat his name like it's a G-O-D, not a D-O-G. Satan wants God's name to be treated like a D-O-G because he knows there's one name under heaven and earth by which men can be saved, and so he wants to make God's name feel like Clorox. He wants to make it as common and as useless as a household product name. I've been on four continents teaching the three-dimensional leader. I assure you, everybody swears in the name of Jesus. Because Satan knows there's one name under heaven and earth by which men can be saved. I've even asked people, because in certain religions they esteem Jesus, they esteem Muhammad. I said, well, why do you curse only in his name? If indeed your religion says that Jesus is more powerful than Muhammad, and Jesus is the one coming back, not Muhammad, why are you cursing in his name? Because there's one name under heaven and earth by which men can be saved. Satan knows that. So when you stub your toe, you don't go, oh, Buddha. Commandment number four, seek the Sabbath. Be a daily Sabbath seeker. For true believers, every day is a Sabbath day. Every day is a day to have a relationship with God. Commandment number five, be faithful to your fellow family members. The Bible says that children are to honor their parents, and it's a two-way street. Parents should be honorable towards their children. Honor is a two-way street. Honor is supposed to be the guiding principle of the home. How do you know you're honoring? You're being faithful to God's word and as you apply it to your family. Commandment number six, it's not anger management that we need to be concerned about, it's mercy management. Mercy mitigates murder. Jesus said that offenses are going to come. People are going to tick you off. Where did the first murder occur? It occurred in a family. I know it doesn't apply to anybody here, but we all know that, you know, in other people's households, families can get on your last nerve. Sexual sanctity satisfies the soul, is commandment number seven. Sexual sanctity satisfies the soul. You show that you honor God by what you choose to do with your body. I have had a band called Earl, Wallace, and the Flood, and we used to sing a song, and it had the word fornication in it. We stopped singing it because so many people came up to us and said, what's fornication? So we're like, we're singing a song a word that no one knows the name of. So one day at rehearsal, one of my band members yelled out, fooling around. We're like, what? He goes, fooling around. What do you mean? He goes, well, we just skipped over, the song is called Troubles in Your Heart. We just skipped over Troubles in Your Heart because we're not going to sing it because we fornication, fooling around. He goes, let's replace that. So we put the song back in the playlist. Sexual sanctity satisfies the soul. Stealing rips you it rips the criminal and the victim out of God's plan for both their material blessings. Sometimes we want to be right with God and we say, well, I want something, so I'm just going to take matters into my own hand. No, you're going to rip yourself out of God's plan for your material blessings. And we're going to apply these to government. It's really bad when government does it. Because government's this big, awful, clumsy thing. Commandment number nine, the truth is all there is to tell. There's 9A and there's 9B. Slander sells us short. I like to think of slander as Satan is a slanderer. And what Satan does is he tells the legitimate truth about you in such a way as to hurt you. He never wants the issue to be how Jesus Christ has covered our sins, how Jesus Christ is working in us. And so, yeah, you feel bad about it. That when you feel that guilt, that's an act of God. That's an act of the Holy Spirit. You should feel guilty when you do something bad. You know what a lot of modern psychology is? It's an attempt to humanize the eradication of guilt, which can only be eradicated by bringing it to God and getting forgiveness. Much of human counseling, secular counseling, is designed to get you to not feel guilty about sin. And we're designed by God. He made us. We're designed to feel guilty about sin. Commandment number 10, coveting clouds the conscience. I realize I probably should have broken these up because maybe you can't see the bottom of the screen from where you're sitting. Can you see this? Can you see this word coveting? Everybody see that? Okay.
Yes.
Coveting clouds the conscience. You may want something so badly that you may begin to entertain hurting another person to get it. Well, the Ten Commandments are all about relationship management. Commandments number 1 through 4, God gives us those commandments because he's telling us how we manage our relationship with him. Commandment 5 is given to us because God wants us to manage our relationships with our families. And commandments 6 through 10, God gives us because he wants to well manage our relationship with society. And your family are also part of society, or our families are also part of society. So we have God, family, and society, relationship management. You can break the Ten Commandments up into 3 groups because they're governing 3 sets of relationships. Your relationship with God is most important. Your relationship with your family is next. Your relationship with society is third. Now, I want to talk about the human history of the quest to get God's freedom in civic life. In the 9th century, King Alfred the Great acknowledged that God gives us our rights. He said that everybody in the kingdom, from the king to the youngest subject, should obey God. And his code, his law code, began with a recitation of the Ten Commandments. People began to get it, that in those commandments are embedded our freedoms. For when God says, thou shalt not murder, he is really saying everyone has a right not to be murdered. We're gonna bounce about 300 years in time for the next few slides. Now in 1215, the Magna Carta acknowledged God's will for man's freedom. There's a book called The 5,000 Year Leap. 5,000 years of human history, people have been trying to figure this out. And God was revealing this to men. He reveals it, they get it, they go forward in time, and they say, hey, it clicks again. Oh, this is how this comes together. This is what God is after here. When Jesus said, I've come to set you free, this is what it all means. Now, the Magna Carta, on June 15th, 2015, if you go back in our, if you go to our YouTube channel, you'll see us do a little presentation on the Magna Carta. June 15, 2015 marks the 800th anniversary of the Magna Carta. This document has been called the foundation of the freedom of the individual against the arbitrary authority of the tyrant or the despot. Guess who wrote the Magna Carta? A representative of the Bible-believing church in England. He was central, a central figure named Bishop Stephen Langton. He negotiated between the lords and the earls and the king to try to codify, to get written into British law, God's will for man's freedom and make it part of the nation's binding legal system. Bishop Stephen Langton of Canterbury was a major drafter of the Magna Carta. One person can write the letter, a committee can edit it, but one person has to be the drafter. Just like Thomas Jefferson was the primary drafter of the Declaration of Independence. Just like James Madison was the primary drafter of the U.S. Constitution. The bishop ensured that the first and last clauses of the Magna Carta stated, and the Church of England shall be free. Because he realized that if the king controls the church would not be free to preach to the people and let them know that God says, you have a right not to be murdered, you have a right not to be stolen from, you have a right not to be lied to, you have a right not to have your property coveted. And the Magna Carta established the Western world's concept of the free church. In schools, we used to teach something called Western civilization, which was nothing more than how Christianity civilized the Western world. Well, if you want to destroy society, you destroy people's knowledge of the Bible. And that's why they attacked the Bible. Because, and now that they've attacked it and they've expunged it from our national conscience, kids actually run around and believe that socialism and communism is a good thing.
Yeah.
And when we say separation of church and state, we're really talking about Russia and China. I was over in the Middle East and a Palestinian said to me, the reason America works is because you have separation of church and state. He had come to me privately before the class and had told me he's really, really, he's feeling choked to death by the Islamic system under which he lives. I didn't want to throw him under the bus in front of the class, so I said, separation of church and state is how Russia and China operate, where the government has no obligation to treat you according to the Ten Commandments. A person raised her hand and she said, what are the Ten Commandments? And I thought, she's either trying to get me killed in here, or she's a closet Christian and she's trying to help me, or she's just naive. Turns out she was a closet Christian and she wanted to keep the conversation going. Anyway, the Magna Carta established the Western world's concept of the free church. That is a church free from government influence because the church is the watchdog of the government. You know, when somebody gets elected to political office, they don't leave the human race. They're not exempt from God's judgment. One out of one person dies, one out of one person faces judgment. In other words, human rights and freedoms are tied to the liberating effects of biblical Christianity. We're going to bounce forward another few hundred years. On May 14, 1624, the Puritans stepped onto Plymouth Rock. Free from government influence, why did they leave Europe? They were seeking religious freedom. Now, they may not have been able to understand it as I'm going to explain it to you today. But within everybody, there's this sense that I've got to be free. I've got to be, what am I trying to be free from? Well, if you read the Bible a lot, you realize after a while, I'm trying to be free from the government killing me. I'm trying to be free from some religion getting the government's ear and having the government persecute me because I'm not part of that religion. So they come to America, they get free from this. They came here for religious freedom. They were escaping religious persecution. They got free and they come to America and they said, God, how shall we then live? There's a book by Francis Schaeffer called How Shall We Then Live? I recommend that everybody go get that book. The Puritans had escaped religious persecution, and in the New World, they created a societal culture rooted in what I call the biblical basis of the Bill of Rights. This founded our legal views on freedom of religion, freedom of speech, the independent press. The press really was run by Christians who were squealing on the government that was trying to do evil to us. The freedom to assemble is part four of this, and the ability to redress the government. I'm going to explain this all in a few moments. But they also codified no forced incrimination. No one could put you under torture to make you confess to something that you didn't do. And if you were going to be in prison, there had to be a grand jury. There had to be a bunch of people secretly looking at evidence and saying to the law enforcement officials, yes, we think this is a crime. Or no, we do not think this is a crime. Leave that person alone. So, in 1776, America's founding fathers declared and codified God's will for people's freedom. And they wrote a document called the Declaration of Independence. That declaration really says three things. It says, number one, our rights come from God. They are inalienable. They are inseparable because God created us. He created us to have these rights, and no king or no government, no earthly ruler or authority can take away those rights.
Hallelujah.
Amen. And they said, the reason governments are instituted by God is so that they can cooperate with God's plan to secure the freedoms and the rights that He gives man. Did you get that bottom filling?
No.
I don't know, let's try to go back. Oops. Let's go back. Okay. Cooperate. Government's role, the Declaration of Independence says that governments are instituted to cooperate with God to secure the rights that He gives people. That's what godly government does. There's no real social justice when a government says, well, we want you to feed the poor, but you can't tell them about Christ. We want you to feed the poor, but we want them condemned to a Christless eternity in hell. So we don't want you to tell anybody about Jesus Christ. When governments suppress Christianity, they are condemning hundreds of millions, if not billions of people, to a Christless eternity. You want to protest something? Protest that social injustice. All right? Now, what did the founding fathers actually have in mind? In their minds, the Bible and the U.S. Constitution, I might have skipped the space, one of your bullets. If I did, I'm coming back to it in the next slide. Right? Do you have the Ten Commandments in your next slide, or do you have, your next fill-in, or do you have this in your next fill-in? You got it? All right. So drop down below that, and you'll see this slide, or you'll see this answer after the Ten Commandments. You see where it says the Bible and the U.S. Constitution?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right. Are so intertwined or connected in the minds of the founding fathers that they gave us the tradition of swearing upon one that we will uphold the other. That's how inseparable this is in their minds. The people who say we were not a Christian nation, I feel like Jesus, when he told the scribes and the Pharisees, you know not the scriptures, nor the power of God. You know not the scriptures, nor the power of God's ability to work through people to codify what God wants codified. People who say we were never a Christian nation, they base it on one scripture where Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world. They said, so therefore, no Christian, no nation could have been a Christian nation. Well, I don't have the kingdom of heaven. I belong there. That's not my kingdom. But God does give us some territory here. I said to those churches, do you own your church property? Who owns it? You or the government? You own it. That's your kingdom on earth. You want God's will done in your kingdom, don't you? What does the Lord's Prayer say? Let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So we're not supposed to implement these things in society?
Yes, we are.
We're supposed to keep our church message within these four walls so nobody else can hear it? Or it can only be heard on the government's terms, and that territory is getting narrower and narrower and narrower. Usually it consists right now of the government being able to go to a funeral and read a few Bible verses to kind of show us that they're Christians. Where they suppress Christianity at every other chance they get and uplift sin. By their fruits ye shall know them. All right. What did the founding fathers intend for we the people? I'm going to show you some quotes by James Madison. But what the founding fathers understood is that commandments number 1 through 4 give us the right to worship God the way he wants to be worshiped. And they codified these primarily in the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. I'm going to show you all the amendments. We're not going to take a whole lot of time with them like I normally do. I'm going to bounce through them, but I'm going to show you that every amendment safeguards your right either not to be murdered, it safeguards your right not to be stolen from by the government, it safeguards your right not to have your person, your people, your position, or your possessions coveted by the government, the 4 P's I call it. The government covets the 4 P's. When they make a trade agreement that ships your job out of the United States of America, government has coveted your position. They're actually coveting your ability to feed your family. Martin Luther King says that if a man says, I have no right to work, he's saying, I have no right to buy food. He's saying, I have no right to exist. Pray for me tonight. I'll be speaking at Proctor's Theater on some of these issues. Commandment number 5, they realize that family and parental rights need to be honored by the government. I was doing a project once with a company, and they were about a $2 million year company, and so they had about $4 million, they had another $2 million of inventory. So we were doing this project with them, and one of the guys was an insurance guy, and he said, you're going to have to take, the principal in the business was 89 years old, and his daughter was 65, who was running the company. And if he died under the new government policies, they have to pay, let's estimate the business at about $4 million in value. They got to pay 50% of the value to the government just for the kids to keep the business. Now, do you know how much it would cost an 89-year-old man to get a $4 million, or at least a $2 million insurance policy just to pay off the government so you can keep what you've worked all your life for? This is sin on a magnitude that you can't even imagine. And we think it's nothing, but God looks at these things extremely and very seriously. And he curses our nation as a result. They realize that commandment number 6 is saying you have a right not to be murdered. Now, if you kill somebody and we take you through court and we do due process and they pronounce you guilty, we can kill you. That's not murder. That's killing after due process. And God tells us that in the Old Testament. There's certain things that's an eye for an eye. Stop doing this to each other. All right, commandment number 7, you have a right not, the founding fathers realize you have a right not to be sexually molested. That's why there's really no statute of limitations on rape cases or murder cases. We can figure out 25 years later through DNA, whatever, they're going to come and get you. What you going to do when they come for you, bad girl? All right, commandment number 8, we have a right not to be stolen from, nor have our property improperly seized. Commandment 9, you have a right not to be lied to or about. At Bible study on the Thursday night, we were going through Exodus, and we looked at this commandment here. What does it mean to bear false witness against your neighbor? There's a really deep discussion about that, but I don't want to bridge that territory here. All right, number 10. You have a right not to have, like I said, the four P's, your person, your property, your people, or your possessions coveted. Are those four P's in your notes? I might, sometimes I run out of space and I can't get them all in there. But it's very, you got to break these things down so you can explain them to people. Free trade agreements that ship your job out of the United States of America. Or when the Environmental Protection Agency comes along and says, oh, this is a bad chemical, it's going to hurt the environment. You can't use them anymore, so they put you out of work. I tell all these people, set your clock and let's look at the environment for 5 minutes. And let's see if it turns brown. And never turns green again. It's a ruse to be, it's a lie against the creative goodness of God. That's what it is. I'm not saying there's no such thing as pollution, but you don't use something that may be real and go overboard and deny millions of people the rights that God gives them. Hey, let's talk about the Supreme Court. Do you know at top of the, I think it's on the south side of the Supreme Court, there is a stone carving in the facade of all the world's lawgivers. They're all facing in to Moses, who's holding the supreme law that man has ever come across, which is the Ten Commandments. Now, we were not a Christian nation, and we had a separation of church and state. So I'm imagining that some college students, some pranksters, snuck up to the Supreme Court building one night, and they somehow carved that there. That carving is there by architectural design, forethought, before a stone was laid. Oh, we were not a Christian nation. Eh, some college pranksters probably did that.
But at least they were talented.
At least they were talented, amen. John Adams, second president, signer of the Declaration of Independence, said, our democratic republic, notice we are a nation of laws, we are a republic, we're a nation of laws that democratically elects its leaders. That's an important distinction. It will thrive as long as citizens obey the Bible. Founding fathers said we're going to let you be free. The Tocqueville comes to America 50 years after the founding of our nation, and he wonders, if people are free, how come they're not, you know, how come there's not anarchy? It's because the founding fathers established, even though it wasn't specifically stated this way, they created a society where you were sort of encouraged, somewhat compelled, to live under the Ten Commandments, to self-govern under the Ten Commandments. And when we choose to self-govern under the Ten Commandments, you don't need a lot of laws to protect each other from which we need to be protected from, right? This was the fabric of our nation. But they're lying to us and telling us, nah, separation of church and state. America was never a Christian nation. And the churches are participating with it, and that's why America's being cursed. Hey, write down in your notes, 97.3 FM.
WHAZ,
97.3 FM, AM 1330. The time will be 12:55 to 1 p.m., but it's radio time, so it's really 12:56 to 1 p.m. Each Monday through Friday, you will hear Ann's mellifluous voice, followed by my cranky voice, my crackling voice. Tomorrow, we're going to explain how the parable of the talents promote capitalism. Because the two servants who were commended by Jesus Christ, the Bible says they traded and they made more talents. The word, the language of communism is, you get what I give. You can't make more. Pray for me, because I'm going to be speaking about this at Proctor's Theater tonight. Now, John Adams wrote in 1798, our Constitution is designed only for a moral and a religious person. Because if you want to be a thief and a scoundrel, if you want to turn sex into some sort of idol, and you get a hold of our government, instead of saying, confessing your sins, you say things like, well, that depends what is. And it ruins the fabric of our nation. Cover the kid's ears. He's just getting started. It's only a religious people who will get government power and not use it to steal, because they fear God more than they fear man. They fear God more than they want things. Make any sense? Here's what James Madison wrote. Now, we're just going to read the bold for the sake of time. We have staked the whole future of American civilization, the future of all our political institutions, upon the capacity of each of us to govern. I like to say self-govern. I gave you a wide enough space so you could write self-govern. To govern ourselves according to the Ten Commandments of God. They created a society where if everybody self-governed under the Ten Commandments, you don't need a whole lot of laws to control them. That's one of the reasons why in almost every other society in the world, where I say their society was not founded in biblical principles, they're all run by dictators. Because believe it or not, you need a strong arm. If you're gonna expunge the Ten Commandments and biblical principles, turn the other cheek, love your neighbor as you love yourself, from your society, from your national conscience, people are gonna kill each other. So you have to have a dictator to control it. And people also don't realize what their freedoms really are, so they kind of accept the dictator. Founding fathers really gave us a wonderful thing. Oh, Thomas Jefferson, but he really didn't believe, did he? You know, the word deus was invented, I think, in the 18th century, in the 1800s, by scoundrel so-called college professors who were studying the founding fathers. They were all deists. They didn't really believe. Oh, you know, Abraham Lincoln, he didn't really learn to read from the Bible. He learned a little bit of phonics or something from that book, and then he threw it away and never opened it again in his life. Here's what Thomas Jefferson said. I've got so many, I have over 500 slides like this that the Lord has blessed me to find and put together on statements like this from the founding fathers of America, going up through the Civil War. Thomas Jefferson said this: of all the systems of morality, ancient and modern, which have come under my observation, none appear to me so pure as that of Jesus. You've seen on the internet where they mentioned that in the White House, I think it was President Kennedy had a dinner one night, and he had all these heads of states and philosophers and these brilliant people at the White House. And he said, this is the greatest collection of minds that has ever graced the White House, except when Thomas Jefferson sat alone and ate.
Wow. Awesome.
Now, that's like saying this is one of the smartest men that ever lived. And look what he is saying. And that's in a letter he wrote to William Canby, dated September 18th, 1813. But the founding fathers were deists. They really didn't believe the Bible. They didn't really apply this stuff. Let's look at Ben Franklin. They always say Thomas Jefferson and Ben Franklin were the least believing of the founding fathers. Ben Franklin said this in a letter to the French ministry in 1778, 2 years into our War of Independence. He was looking for funding for the war. Benjamin Franklin said, whoever shall introduce into public affairs the principles of primitive Christianity, because that's how the French regarded it, will change the face of the world. And we did. Daniel Webster, he says, if we abide by the principles taught in the Bible, our country will go on prospering and to prosper. But if we and our posterity, our next generation, if we neglect its instructions and its authority, no man can tell how sudden a catastrophe will overwhelm us and bury all of our glory in profound obscurity. We can die quick. People will be scratching their heads like the Bible says, you'll become a byword, like, wow, man, wow, look what happened to them. You know, everywhere I go in the world, people ask me, Mr. Wallace, why is your country turning its back on all the principles that made it a great nation? And they start getting upset with me. Are you crazy? What are you people doing? And I said, we're trying to stop this. All right, George Washington added to his first oath of office. It wasn't it wasn't a plan. He spontaneously did this. He said, so help me God, and he picked up the Bible and kissed it. And he wasn't being perfunctory. He was making a heartfelt cry to God. This is a new thing. And I'm a sinner. I can't do it, God. If you don't help us, we're not going to make it. At his 1796 farewell address, Washington declared this: reason and experience, both everything I've ever thought about and everything I've ever experienced or done, both forbid us to expect the national morality can prevail in exclusion of religious principles. This is one of the first quotes I read that led me to discover the biblical basis of the Bill of Rights. I was like, well, what's morality got to do with it? I mean, I'm a Christian, I believe in morality, right? We want morality, but how does it connect to our civics and our politics? That statement there led me to the discovery of what I call the biblical basis of the Bill of Rights. Here's what Thomas Jefferson also said. A Bill of Rights, he says the Bill of Rights limits government and it frees the people so they can be empowered as the Bible wants them to be. A Bill of Rights is what the people are entitled to against every government. I wish they had renamed the Bill of Rights, or named the Bill of Rights, the Ten Commandments to government. Because then people would understand it. Right? It's kind of confusing. We read the Bill of Rights and it's not about us, it's all about government. As a kid, we read the Bill of Rights, like, well, what's it got to do with me? Where's my rights? I couldn't figure it out. The Bill of Rights are saying, government thou shalt not, government thou shalt not, government thou... When government stays in its lane, we the people enjoy freedom. A Bill of Rights is what the people are entitled to against every government and what no just government should refuse. A wise and frugal government, which shall restrain men from injuring one another, shall leave them otherwise free to regulate their own pursuits of industry. The Bible, he said this, the Bible is the cornerstone of liberty. Students, perusal of this sacred volume, that's why the founding fathers put Bibles in schools. Students' perusal of this sacred volume will make us better citizens, better fathers, and better husbands. Do you know, in the Middle East, I've had Muslims tell me the exact same thing. When they press me and ask me, where did you get this thing called three-dimensional leadership? And I finally confess, I got it out of the Bible. And they turn to each other, some of them, and they say, well, you know, if you listen, read the Bible, especially the New Testament, you will become a better father, a better husband, a better employer, a better employee. All right, let's show the connections now between the Ten Commandments and the Bill of Rights. On the left side of your screen, you have the Bill of Rights, and on the right side of the screen, you have the commandment that those Bill of Rights are safeguarding or empowering us to be able to implement in our personal and our public lives. Founding fathers had no problem with us going to high school football games and praying or pledging allegiance to the flag or singing a national song that thanks God for what he has done for our beloved United States of America. Amendment number one begins with freedom of religion. You know why? Because it's safeguarding the right per commandments 1-4 to worship God the way the Bible says. And you know why they put religion first? Because the biblical Christianity, the biblical philosophy of Christianity, the philosophy of biblical Christianity is supposed to inform our national conscience. It's not supposed to be expunged. It's not supposed to be hidden. We're not supposed to have churchianity. We're supposed to have Christianity. Freedom of speech. The Bible is supposed to guide what we speak up for and out against. The Bible is supposed to guide how the press is supposed to conduct itself. If the press wants to promote something as crime or publish something as criminal behavior, it should be consistent with what the Bible calls sin. If the newspaper wants to promote something as noteworthy, it should be consistent with what the Bible calls praiseworthy. Freedom to assemble. Thomas Jefferson and Ben Franklin said, how are we going to get people to understand these things? And they started, Thomas Jefferson and Ben Franklin started a church in the halls of Congress at which 8,000 people on average attended every week. Because they wanted separation of church and state, not. They wanted the state to bow to biblical Christianity. It's the only way that we, the people, would have freedom. And they gave us, the right in the First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution, they gave us that they admonished us, they're encouraged, they're pushing us. Redress your government. Petition the government. You know what they're saying? They're saying if your government strays from the biblical basis of the Bill of Rights, mash yourselves together and go drag your government back onto a godly path. All right, this is just another slide that shows what Bill has read and what I'm telling you right now. The First Amendment conjoins five rights. Freedom of religion. So you can publicly practice biblical Christianity. Not some politically correct government-sponsored version of Christianity that only allows you the social gospel. Feed the poor. You know why about the government's always into feeding the poor? Because every dictator on the face of the planet has come to power on the promise of feeding the poor. The dictator says, I'm going to feed the poor. We all go, I want that. Who wouldn't? And we vote for it. So they use the social gospel to deny the real gospel, and we Christians fall for it. All right? Biblical Christianity, or freedom of religion, freedom of speech, they're all conjoined. Again, once again, your speech should conform to Christianity. We shouldn't have smut speech on TV. Freedom of the press. The press shouldn't be lying and covering for lying politicians. Of course, now we realize that evil people who hate the Bible have bought the press. So we see we have internet press. We're still trying to get to the truth.
Hallelujah.
Number four, the reason why we assemble should be so that we could publicly profess Christianity. And number five, if the government strays, redress your government. Drag them back onto a biblical path. Get your remedy. Make any sense?
Yes.
Now, I just want to highlight a couple of the amendments. Amendment number two. That amendment, in the minds of the founding fathers, gives us the ability to safeguard our rights under commandment number six, which says, thou shalt not murder. Which really means you have a right not to be murdered. So the government says, the godly government says, here's a gun, live by the Ten Commandments, love your neighbor, turn the other cheek, but if that man comes in your house to hurt your family, shoot him. Yeah. Expunge the sin from Israel. If I turn in my weapon, I'll call the police if I have a chance. My neighbors may call the police if they hear the crime. And they'll come after the crime is done and the smoke has settled from the shooting. And they'll suit up and they'll take their time and the bad guy will be long gone. The founding father said, defend yourself. You have a right not to be murdered. We have a right for a government not to put us in a position where we can be murdered. I go overseas and people, we have these discussions and we get to the point where they talk about gun control. And I'm like, do you think really Boko Haram is going to give up its guns? You think the UN's going to go take the guns from Boko Haram? Well, if the UN really wanted to, it should, it could, but it doesn't. I want you to give in your guns. Why? Maybe the UN is not our friend. Maybe UN really stands for undermining national sovereignty everywhere.
That's what they do.
That's what they do. As a matter of fact, a good rule of thumb is if the government calls something free trade, it's probably going to be just the opposite of that for you. So whatever the name of the program is, just think of the opposite. That's probably where it's, the root determines the fruit. All right. As I said, all the other amendments, quartering soldiers, the right of your rights against improper search and seizure, all these amendments are safeguarding our rights under commandments 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. You have a right not to, under the prosecution provision, government can't sneak around, spy on you, manipulate others to lie about you, falsify information against you, bear false witness. And they can't make excessive bail and hold you forever. That's like stealing your person. You have a right to a speedy trial. You have to have witnesses, that, and the hell has to be set up with the jury of your peers. See, all these things are safeguarding our rights under those commandments. But I want to highlight Bill of Right number 9, because this is the one we kind of know the least about. It's called the Rule of Construction of the Constitution. And it means this. Congress can't make a law that violates any other part of the Bill of Rights. They can't, government can't make a law that says you got to register your guns. It's unconstitutional. But they do that. Now, God honors his Ten Commandments. And every time the government steps outside of its lane, it's getting into an area that's putting an umbrella over us that God is going to curse us. I will say this. The founding fathers were flowing, I believe, in such a prophetic tradition that they constructed this thing so tightly that you cannot violate a Bill of Rights without at least violating one of the Ten Commandments and vice versa. And when government violates one of the Ten Commandments, it's violating the way God wants us to live. That's why they suppress the knowledge of the Bible. Because when people realize that God wants me to have something that you're trying to take from me, they will not fear government. They will stand up as Gideon did, as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did, as David did against Goliath. So they suppress the truth of the Bible so they can enslave us. Is truth set you free? What will lies do? What will withholding of information do? Number 10, Bill of Rights number 10. It says the states and the people have rights not expressly given to the federal government. This is what we call enumerated rights. The government only has the rights that are specifically listed in the U.S. Constitution. Every other right belongs to the states or to you. All of these agencies that are making laws, that's how communist Russia works. They make an agency called the EPA or whatever, and it makes a rule that you've got to live by. So, and under our Constitution, all laws are supposed to be voted on by Congress. But they went backdoor on us. Now, the Founding Fathers expected the Bible to be the conscience and guide of social life and government life. None of the First Amendment. We already covered that, but I'm going to give you this slide. We always talk about mission, vision, and values. Here's the mission, vision, and values of the United States of America. The USA became a cohesive, unified, stable, and productive society because people, including politicians, treated each other according to the Ten Commandments and other biblical values. I call them now the political class. They're a Ten Precepts class of people. The Ten Precepts were invented by Adam Weishaupt in 1776, and they are the opposite of the Ten Commandments. They're very perverted. Think about, you know, only have sex with someone that you're married to, but oh no, we're going to have it with everybody, and dogs and animals. So it's very perverted. So what they did is they hired Karl Marx to make a more politically acceptable version of the Ten Precepts. It's still government's God, and government's the boot and you're the ant. But it's more socially acceptable. So much so now we hear Bernie Sanders, and we have college kids running all over the place self-proclaiming themselves as communists or socialists. And socialism is nothing more than communism. Do they both suppress the Bible? Do they both put Christians in jail? Do they outlaw scripture? Don't think one's any better than the other. Jesus said, I'll spit you out of my mouth. Don't be hot or cold. You can't be lukewarm. They say socialism's lukewarm. Well, it's really not. It suppresses Christianity. It condemns people to a Christless grave. God is having no part of it. The USA became a cohesive nation because people lived under the values of the Ten Commandments. Now, business is facilitated when people decide not to steal. All business is based on a handshake, based on commandment number 8, thou shalt not steal. Win-win deals are made when people decide to love thy neighbor as thyself and turn the other cheek. This is where we get all these concepts that our businesses have been built on. They all come from the Bible. Mistakes are covered when people decide to turn the other cheek and love your neighbor as you love yourself. Do unto others. And we pray in the Lord's Prayer, forgive me my trespasses as I forgive those who trespass against me. We're getting ready to close here. John Jay, who was an early governor, he may have been the first governor of New York, but he was the first chief Supreme Court justice. He said this. He says in the bottom here, he says, Providence has given to our people the choice of their rulers. And it is the duty, as well as the privilege and interest of a Christian nation to select and prefer Christians for their rulers. There were two Supreme Court cases in the 1790s, I think 1798 or 1799, where the Supreme Court actually ruled, yes, America is a Christian nation. We didn't state it overtly in our documents, but the tenor, the base, the foundation intertwined through all of our founding documents are biblical principles. We are a Christian nation. If truth sets you free, what are lies designed to do? John Jay wrote this in a letter to Jedediah Morse on February 28, 1797. Now, here's the problem in America. Judges 2, 8 through 10 tells, and I spent a lot of time on this on the radio last week. Judges 8 through 10 tells us this, and Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, and all that generation also were gathered to their fathers. So Joshua and all of his peers died. Joshua was Moses' successor. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work he had done for Israel. Can you imagine this? A couple of generations after people passed through the Red Sea, led by a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day, after millions of people are being fed by manna, after a generation arose that neither knew the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. This is what's happened in America when people talk about Christian nationalism. Oh, world, you're preaching Christian nationalism. Well, what do you think is going to happen when Jesus' millennial kingdom is here on earth?
Amen.
Won't be any separation of church and state then. Here's what we need to do. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal their land. God is saying we've got to do four things, and he'll do three. But it's an if-then proposition. If you don't do your four, he's not going to do his three. And he's not impressed by us. He doesn't care how much we whine. He doesn't care how much we pray, go to national prayer events. And we go. And our churches are all organized under 501c3 separation of church and state. Pastor emailed me last week and he goes, well, in Jesus' millennial kingdom, we'll be able to preach the Bible preach the Bible freely. I wrote him back. I said, dude, the Bible, black and white words on the page of the Bible don't change in China or Russia or because we got what we have in the White House. If we don't repent of this lie of separation of church and state, we are not repenting. And unfortunately, many, many young people, once I explain this to them, they say, Mr. Wallace, my generation is going to have hell to pay. We want God to hear from heaven. We want him to forgive. And we want him to heal our land. Repent of this primary lie through which the entire Church of America practically is now organized. 501c3, a policy invented by the IRS to get churches to stand down from politics, to get their righteousness from being applied to the government. And since then, we have politicians say, well, I'm not going to let my personal beliefs affect my public policy. I'm like, that's cursing me. We pray in the Lord's Prayer, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I'm going to close with this. What do we need to do? Well, we need to receive Jesus Christ and practice that faith that inspired the disciples and the founding fathers. We need to make sure that the First Amendment is primary in all of our politics. I think we need to start a national movement, a litmus test called, do you believe the Ten Commandments? If you don't, we're not voting for you. How do we know you believe the Ten Commandments? By their fruits ye shall know them. Don't put out a publication telling me you're a Christian and you're lying about somebody, some other politician. Good process leads to good outcomes. Bad process always leads to a bad outcome in God's economy. Bad process is my will for God. That's what Saul did, and he got himself into a lot of trouble. Every Sunday, therefore, should be a pulpit freedom Sunday. You know, we all come from different churches, and I thank you so much for coming here. But if you're in a church and your church won't do this, you need to get out of that church. Because you're participating in that which is destroying our nation. That's what I mean by churchianity, not Christianity. Number two, give glory to God and don't cave in and give Caesar what is God's. I don't want to throw Chris under the bus, but Chris Hopkins said this to us on Thursday night so eloquently. I'm going to do the best I can. I didn't write it down. If I get it wrong, see Chris, he'll get it right with you. We are so afraid of losing what we have left that we will not take a risk to gain what we cannot otherwise achieve. Vote biblical values. Support only candidates and politicians who demonstrate a Ten Commandments value system. Join biblically based movements like Liberty Christian Fellowship that teaches and advocates applying scripture to civic life and politics. Tell and teach others about the relevance of biblical values and especially the Ten Commandments so that people can get converted to real Christianity, not a Churchianity, a sanitized, politically correct version of religion.